I'm Wade Price, and just like corn, I care not from where the blood flows. Today's guest on VoxCast is Alexander Tuxford from the Warhammer 40,000 studio, who's been responsible for a number of codexes and books and Vox games, such as Codex Astra Militarum, Codex Grey Knights, Realm of Chaos Wrath and Rapture, and Warhammer Quest Blackstone Fortress. Hey, Alex.
Hey, Wade, how's it going?
It's good, thank you. I'm very good. How are you?
Not too bad, thanks.
Welcome to VoxCast.
Thank you for having me.
So we're going to talk about your current role and your last role, I guess. What you do now in the Warhammer 40,000 studio and what you've done in the past that people might be already familiar with in the Warhammer 40,000 studio.
Yeah, so I used to be a background writer and I've spoken with you and other people in that capacity about some of the products that I've worked on.
Yep.
I've recently moved into a slightly different role in the Warhammer 40,000 studio, a role that you yourself are very familiar with.
Indeed.
So we should have some fun talking about what that is, perhaps a little bit later on.
Yeah. We are the only living humans ever in documented history to have had the role of Warhammer 40,000 product developer.
Yes.
That's pretty cool.
That is correct. Yeah.
We'll talk about that in a little bit. And I'll just point out, for the benefit of anyone who's listening to the recording rather than watching the video of the podcast, we have a few of Alex's greatest hits dotted around in the studio. Mm-hmm. So there's the box of Blackstone Fortress behind your head, because you wrote all the background, all the lore.
I did indeed.
Everything to do with Warhammer Quest Blackstone Fortress. And I'm sure we'll get into that in a little while. And also a number of codexes, because you worked on Codex Grey Knights, Codex Astra Militarum, Codex Thousand Suns, Codex Space Wolves.
Drukhari
as well. I forgot that one. Criminal. Yeah. So a number of codexes, a number of boxed games as well. We'll talk about some
Wrath
of your
greatest.
Wrath and Rapture, my favourite.
Realm
of Chaos, Wrath and Rapture behind me as well. Mm-hmm. It's got some fine hits in that back catalogue.
Yeah, thank you.
So traditional VoxCast sort of introductory setup. Yeah. How did all of this come to be? How did you get exposed to Warhammer and Games Workshop in the first place, I guess? And then how did you get to the studio after
that? I got sort of into the hobby in the a very similar way to some of your other guests on VoxCast. I started with Hero Quest and Space Crusade that friends had, and I used to go to their house and play it as much as I could and annoy them and call them up and say, can I come over and play those games again? And what I also really enjoyed doing was reading like the rule books and all the snippets of lore and on the cards, and it would describe what's happening and who the monsters are and who the heroes are and what these weapons did. And I just thought that was the coolest stuff ever. And then I got hold of like some White Dwarfs from back in 1993, 1994 that some friends had. And I started seeing like the full range of miniatures and that there was this whole other world that you could play these games in, not just the board games that I'd seen advertised on television, but these expansive games with different factions and different races of aliens and monsters and tanks and dreadnoughts. And again, for me, what I was most drawn to was the sort of background content and the stories and that sort of thing. And I had a bit of an interesting hobby journey in that I didn't really play a lot of the games. I tried my hand a little bit at modeling and painting. I never really took to it, and it wasn't the way that I particularly chose to engage with the hobby. It was more reading the background and, funnily enough, the rules as well as a way to understand the universes that were being portrayed.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to get hold of codexes and read them like cover to cover, and reading the rules as a way of understanding, okay, this weapon is a poison weapon and it does this effect, and that's what is described in this little snippet in the front half of the book. And I just found that a fascinating way to explore this imaginary universe that felt so real and had been so fleshed out in so many different places.
They're almost like mathematical proofs, the rules of that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes,
exactly.
I can see how that would work. Yes.
Yeah, it's the same as having like a diagram or a map that you might have. It was something that gave a concrete weight to the thing that had been described elsewhere. It was describing it in a different way that for a different part of my brain gave
it. Quantify it.
Exactly, and made it tangible.
Mm-hmm.
So even though I didn't necessarily engage much with the rules against an opponent on the tabletop, they meant a lot to me as a way of understanding the world that I was getting more and more in love with.
Yeah.
And that was true for Warhammer Fantasy at the time as well, and for 40K, and all the like little like side games that popped up over that time as well. I remember when Necromunda came out, and that was when I kind of realized, oh yeah, there are normal people as well, like not on the like front lines. and they've still got a fight to survive.
Yeah.
And then seeing like Epic Space Marine and seeing the scale of it with Titans and Stompers and all these enormous things that could be part of that world, and seeing the depth and the breadth of everything that was covered by it was just a gateway that sort of I've been walking through ever since.
Yeah.
Basically.
So seeing the miniatures, a bit like seeing the rules, is that just kind of solidifying your understanding of what you thought was cool about the background text that you wrote?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's a different facet of the same thing that inspired my imagination. I'd see the great sort of photos of the middle of battle reports where it had the different armies facing off. And to me, that was like a journalist had taken a photo of something, of a story that was playing out in that world. And it was something that then my mind could take over and tell that story. And for me, that's what the hobby was primarily, was a set of tools that allowed my imagination to go to these amazing places. And whether that was by making my own miniatures the few times that I actually did that and painting them, albeit not very well.
What did you make them out of?
No, I used various kits that I would sort of kit bash together. Okay. to make models that was sort of my variants on things. Like I think one time I made minotaurs using the river trolls and the Mornfang like tusks as horns, all sorts of things.
Yeah.
That I just tried seeing, like, well, if these sculptors can make these amazing miniatures, what other things can I make? And it was always a way to expand my thinking. I'd always been into science fiction and fantasy and that sort of thing, and seeing how much work had been done in the writing and in the art and in the photography and the models and everything, it just made me realize there's people whose whole life is dedicated to creating these fantasy worlds. And I always thought that would be something that would be amazing to be part of. And it turned out that I was fortunate enough to end up working for Games Workshop and being able to be part of that and be able to do that for my life. So yeah, happy ending to that story.
Was there a time in your childhood where you thought that was a realistic ambition, that one day you might be responsible for writing this background?
Not particularly realistic, no. So I grew up in New Zealand, and so Nottingham was this far distant exotic location that where everything was made of like miniature space marines and that sort of thing. And I thought, wow, it's literally the other side of the world. I don't see myself ever being able to get there, but fortunately that they send stuff over here, so I get to enjoy it. But yeah, then as I got older and I started doing a bit of traveling, and I lived in Germany for a while, and I realized, oh, they've got Games Workshop stores here as well. Mm-hmm. And then I traveled to a few other places and ended up in the UK, and I was like, I found myself, in Nottingham, and this is where the headquarters are.
And a sign.
Yeah, and I ended up just applying for a job that I was fortunate enough, the timing was such that I was looking for work, being kind of new in the country, and they had a job going for a background writer at that time, for a background for both Age of Sigmar and Warhammer 40,000. And I applied, and I went through the process and sent in writing samples and went to the interviews, and I got the job.
You did.
Yeah, and I haven't really looked back since, and I've encouraged everyone else to not look back either, because I still think that, I'm not 100% sure how I managed to get through the door, but once I was in, I started learning from the best, people whose names I was familiar with from years of being a fan of the hobby, people such as Jervis Johnson or Phil Kelly or Robin Crudas, whose names had popped up consistently for years and years, and then finding myself sitting next to these people whose work I had admired for such a long time, and learning the skills of the trade from them, learning how to develop these fantasy worlds, learning how to be the aperture that opens up to allow people's imaginations to expand, to provide people with those tools for their own hobby experience. It's not just a case of when you're working for Games Workshop, pursuing your own hobby experience. It's providing that framework that allows other people to take their hobby where they want it to go. And yeah, it's been exciting and challenging and rewarding and a lot of fun. And yeah, the best part, I think, of all, and you'd probably agree with this, is you get to work with a lot of people who are really passionate about what they do.
Hugely. Yeah.
Yeah, and people who care deeply about doing the job well, because it means that the hobby as a whole is doing well.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, that I think is the most satisfying part of it, is working with those people towards a common purpose that you all care about.
Yeah. Yeah. I work with a number of people who all think they've got the best job in the world.
Yeah.
And they're all idiots, because obviously I do.
Yeah.
But I think it's a great indicator of people happy doing what they're doing.
Yeah.
They all think that their job is the best and they want to keep doing their job.
Yeah.
So yeah, everyone keeps pulling in the same direction to keep achieving that same end.
Absolutely. And it's just, I think it's something that is encouraging. Everyone has, you know, days when you're tired and you've been working really hard and you might be stressed with a particular project you're working on or a particular goal that you've got to reach. But knowing that at any given time, you know, you can reach out to the people around you and they will give you support, because ultimately they want the thing that you're all working on to be in the best shape that it can be in.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, you all care about the quality of it, because it's something that you want to enjoy in years to come yourself. You know, you want to be able to look back upon your work and remember it as an amazing part of, you know, the Warhammer 40,000 experience that you are participating in yourself. Yeah, and that's true of a lot of people who work here. A lot of people have been fans of the hobby before they came to work here. Yeah, and that really carries through into what they do.
Yeah.
Yeah, even if people have somewhat different hobby experiences, like, for example, myself. Yeah, until I actually came here, I'd played relatively few Games Workshop games, although I knew the rules and had read the background. But actually playing the games, it wasn't until I got here and met a lot of people who were like, come on, you've got to start playing the games now, and would actually challenge me and wipe the floor with me, but in a very fun way.
Yeah.
So
you said your route to the studio was maybe not the most conventional, the most direct route, and everyone's application process, I guess, will be slightly different. So your application process will not necessarily be the same as it would be for everyone.
Yeah.
But do you remember what you wrote for your applications?
Yeah, so first of all, it was just like a cover letter to apply for it, saying like why you want the job.
Always important.
Yeah, yeah. And I think I said something along the lines of, I want to work for Games Workshop because Games Workshop has the best IP in the world. Absolutely believe that, and I still do, and that is why I wanted to work here.
Mm.
And I went on to say other things. It wasn't just that, and then send the letter off. And then after that, I got through to the next round and they asked for writing samples, and it was about four different samples of different word lengths. I think it was like a 1,000 word narrative story about a battle between Imperial Fists and Orcs, and a 300 word box out on Eldari Guardians, I think it was. And I remember working very hard for each of these to get it to like the exact word length, like not 10% above or below, but like to exactly 300 and exactly like 1,000 words or whatever it was. And the most difficult one was write a 50 word introduction to, what was it? Khorne Battle Tome.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Bloodbound Battle Tome. And doing that in 50 words, trying to get exactly 50 words, was really difficult, just to sum up everything into such a short, succinct space. But that was so helpful. That was, I think doing that is a skill that I have continued to develop in working here, is being able to sum up something succinctly. When you have very little space, you have to get so much more impact in that space that you have.
Yeah.
And every word needs to be doing a lot of work. You can't have superfluous words, and you can't have stuff that just works as padding. Like, every word has to hit home. And so you have to be that much more careful with every single word that you're using. But that's a great skill, because you should be doing that in everything.
Yep.
You know, whether you're writing something that's 50 words or 10,000 words, every word should be doing your job. And you kind of end up training yourself when you're working on those really difficult focus tasks like that to make sure that every word counts. And then you carry that skill over into the larger projects, and that's how your writing gets better.
I guess as a background writer, that being briefed to write a certain number of words, that is hugely important, because any of the ideas in the 41st millennium, you could sum up in an elevator pitch very loosely. You could write a treatise on and write thousands of words on.
Yeah.
And as a background writer, you wouldn't always have the freedom of choice as to what number of words you'd have to write about
exactly.
a particular topic.
And we know for a fact that this has happened. Like I think it was in a previous one of the VoxCasts, you're talking about the Horus Heresy, where what started as a throwaway, or not throwaway, but a very quick sort of reference to something that had happened in the past of the 41st millennium has turned into, I wouldn't hazard a guess at how many words have been written on it now, but a massive, expansive sort of body of work that is nowhere near exhaustive.
No.
You can keep diving into that, or you can crystallize it into one sort of notion. And it's that ability to be able to do that is really important in what we do, because again, that's what allows people to take it where they want to go with their mind. If someone loves to indulge in something and read something that someone else has written that takes them on a story, you've got a long story for that, a long form bit of writing. If they want just an idea of something, that then their mind can fill in the blanks, it's got to be able to do that as well. And as a writer, and when you're working on these books, sometimes you have to make that call as to what is the most appropriate thing. You can't afford to go into great length on every single topic that you think is cool. Sometimes you just need to give it a little sting and let people's minds sort of take it the rest of the way. And finding out how to do that where it doesn't just confuse people that you've referenced something and don't really explain what it is, that's a real skill. You have to give just enough of a hook for them to sort of self-perpetuate and to continue developing their idea and their own imagination. It's planting a seed that grows, and then you can refer back to that in another book sometimes. Yeah. And that's something that can be really fun to do when you're working across different codexes, is you can plant like a little hint of an idea in one, and then do a little hint of the same idea in another, and then a little hint of the idea in the third. And overall, you might have written a total of 30 words. But because it's three different perspectives and three different books, people able to fill in the space between and make it into like a fully formed idea that has its own weight.
And in 10 years' time, there'll be a Black Library series devoted to it.
That's the hope. And that's the thing. It's creating the potential for that sort of thing rather than the definite there will be something that takes shape from it.
Yeah.
Because also, it needs to be something that people with their own hobby can take on board and write their own campaign about or set their games in, or take the idea of a character that's kind of mentioned only by name and perhaps one of their deeds and make that the basis for their whole collection and their whole army around this particular thing that has resonance with them. It's the ability to sort of provide that inspiration without necessarily telling people how to do something. And some people like having that guidance of saying, you know, do this, make your army like this, take your hobby in this direction, you'll have a lot of fun with it. Other people just need that little bit of inspiration and then they want to run wild with it, you know. And it's writing in such a way that all of those people are catered to. That's the challenge, but also the real joy, because you get to express ideas in different ways and different forms. And sometimes you get to be very verbose and say all sorts of things and get into all sorts of grisly details, particularly when working on things like Drukhari, where some of those details are particularly nasty, can be quite satisfying. But other times when they're really, really nasty, you just want to hint at it and then step back and let people's brains do the dirty work for you.
We definitely had some discussions in the making of the Drukhari Codex about some of that content.
Yes.
I remember that.
I remember that was a pushback of one thing I wrote where it was, this is too nasty.
Please don't say that. Let people imagine it, but we can't print that. Obviously, we can't allude, we can't even describe what those words were.
I remember that very specifically, working on that book, is that when I started working on it, everything I was writing was like, oh, this is horrible. After, you know, a couple of weeks on it, you're just completely blind to that. Yeah, it's just like, it's cut off his face, you know? Like, what's the difference?
You can grow another one.
Yeah, that's what you do. And so then when you try to say something that's a little bit sort of hard-hitting and kind of gets to something that's quite nasty or disturbing about the Drukhari, if you're already kind of at that baseline level of everything seems normal about them, you end up writing something that's absolutely revolting. And that's why you have other people around you to read over it and look at it and say, no, dial that back. That is the sort of thing that people can fill in with their own brains. But yeah, you don't want to just put something out there that is absolutely horrific. And
it's all 11 out of 10.
Yeah. But again, that's a great thing about working with people who are so passionate about what they do, is people can observe where you're going wrong and steer you back on course. Mm-hmm. And that can come from anywhere. Again, I think other people on this podcast have said that. It's not just people within your own discipline who steer you in the right direction. It's not just the writers that I've worked alongside who've taught me how to be a better writer. It's people who work in the art department or the layout department or the rules department and the editorial department, definitely. Photographers, you know, anyone who's kind of working on the same project as you might read something that you've read to inspire what they're doing. Mm. And then give you a pushback saying, you know what, I think you could do better here. And that's really great, because if they're saying it, you probably can do better. And yeah. it's almost like having a whole bunch of personal trainers pushing you past your limits and making you get better at what you do. And that's really fun. And you come away better at your job for doing it and more proud of what you've written, and you enjoy what you write more. And hopefully that translates to how people out in the world enjoy it as well.
Did you have any, because I know the 40K studio has recently taken on some new background writers and games developers. Did you have any advice for the newer background writers? Anything that no one told you and you really wished that they told you when you'd started?
Well, I think everyone's approach to writing is a little bit different. And so I told them that, but I think from my point of view, I always approach everything as, don't look for the stuff that you like. Look for the stuff that you're dissatisfied with, which sounds kind of negative. But what I mean by that is you can look for, everyone's inspired by fiction that they like, you know, whether it's films, novels, other codexes they may have read. Find the ones that you really love, but find out if it's 99% perfect, what's that 1% that's off? And identify that and figure out how to not do that. And I think that's the trick. Like, I'm quite into films myself, and I've watched a lot. And the best ones that I can think of, the ones that are sort of high up on my top 10 list, I can still think of like little nitpicks with them. And being able to identify those things where something's gone not quite right or could have been done better, that's how you got to improve. It's no good just to sort of find the good stuff and be like, yeah, that's great. Mm-hmm. More of that, please. You got to find out how to avoid those pitfalls. And the more you can do that, avoiding the things that you don't want to do, that kind of opens you up to do the rest in whatever way you want. Rather than trying to emulate the good stuff always, you avoid the negatives, and then you can experiment with the other stuff. And so you're not doing something that's formulaic. You're not always doing the one good thing that you've seen in other books. You're free to try lots of different things, so long as you're not doing the stuff that you don't want to see in your writing. There's a classic thing in writing that's called, like, as you know, Bob. It's the whole thing of two people walk into a room and say, well, as you know, Bob, we're off to, you know, whatever, have a picnic today. And this is a conversation these two characters would have had before, but they're having it for the benefit of whoever's reading it to get that information. And it's that sort of thing. If you know to avoid that, don't do that. Mm-hmm. You can do lots of other things. You can get that information across in lots of other exciting, interesting ways. But just don't do the thing that's stupid, because it's stupid.
And it's been identified as
and
such.
It's been identified as stupid. And if you've noticed that it's stupid, other people will too. So if there's things that you like from writing, things that you don't like and that irritate you and irk you, they're probably going to annoy other people too. So don't do that stuff that's going to irritate you, because other people won't like it either. Mm. Avoid that, and then you can kind of create. And then go back to the stuff that you've written after a while and read over it. And if there's stuff in that that irritates you, identify that and go, okay, I won't do that anymore. I'll try something new. And that's kind of how you develop, is you learn what you shouldn't be doing, and then you try something new. Yeah. And sometimes you find something you really like and you stick to it for a while, but you gotta keep it fresh, so you try new things as well.
So I'm going to talk a little bit more about some of the projects that you have worked on as a background writer, and just to get your thoughts, I guess, on some of them or what the experiences were like. And I remember the first thing you worked on was Shadow War Armageddon.
Yes.
Which was quite a deep end to be thrown into as your first project to work on, because a lot of the time when people start in the studio, you can go, oh good, you're working on the new version of a thing we've made several times before, and we can sit you down with the last time someone wrote a Dark Eldar codex, maybe.
Yeah. Or this person's working on a codex, help them out with some bestiary texts or something like that. Yeah, that is how some people start. I was, in my opinion, fortunate enough to be given a project to work on day one. Mm. And it was a smaller project in terms of the background writing work required. But yeah, it did require me to kind of think, all right, this is what the project is supposed to be about.
For anyone who doesn't know, just explain, Shadow War Armageddon was a little skirmish game, a kind of forerunner to the recent edition of Kill Team, kind of filling a gap for a 40k skirmish game, and it used the second edition Warhammer 40,000 rules, what had been the original Necromunda rules, which hobbyists of a certain vintage, such as ourselves, are probably quite familiar with, in theory, if not in practice.
Yeah.
And that worked quite well, but it was a great opportunity to zoom in on Hive and Furnace. I think that was the setting, wasn't it? We had the existing...
Trying to remember which hive it was now, because I remember that was my task on day one, was pick a hive that it set in.
I might be wrong. It's in the past now. But it was certainly to develop the setting of one of the existing hives on the hive world of Necromunda.
Acheron.
Was it Acheron? Yeah.
Yeah.
Fair play, it was indeed. Yeah. It was the Promethean caches and Hive Acheron.
Yeah.
So it was an opportunity to take, I guess, what people... And you talked about it already with the Drakkari stuff, taking some elements of background that people would know.
Yeah.
Because it's always a nice nostalgic warming in the heart when you see something. Yeah, I learned that. Mm. I spent my formative years learning some of the history of the world of Armageddon, and now I've been vindicated.
Yeah, you get to feel validated of like, this isn't a waste of time, Mum. You know?
One day I will have a job doing this.
and taking those little seeds of information scattered in the recesses of my brain.
Yeah.
That had been planted there by me over, you know, many years, and then collating them and actually sitting down with a bunch of the books that I'd read in the past and some that had slipped past my notice and reading them and thinking, right, I've got to tell a new chapter in this story. So, you know, I better get to work. I better piece together those things and make sure that my understanding of it sort of is correct and that I'm telling something cohesive and that I'm not just telling the story that I want to tell, but I'm telling the story that is right for the setting and right for the characters involved and that makes the best setting for this cool skirmish game with, you know, Space Marine scouts and Astra Militarum veterans and orcs in the Underhive, like, chasing each other around and bashing each other. Yeah. And that was really cool. Mm. Just taking something that I was familiar with, doing something new with it, in a fairly concise little package. That did really well. You know, people really liked that game. You know, I think there's still people who play that game. Yeah. And I'm really proud of the setting. I think it's really fun and it had a really cool story that went along with it. And it was a great opportunity to show like a different aspect of the 41st millennium. Yeah. And I think that's what a lot of these sorts of games do. And a lot of the most exciting bits of writing for me is you have the big stuff on the front lines and then it's those little details off on the peripheries. Mm. I was always really drawn to those. Mm. I love a big battle, you know. I love the big epic characters. But then when you focus in on the little people on the fringes who might just survive this crazy mission that they're going on, this basic suicide mission, that's when it gets really cool for me. And so being able to sink my teeth into that, like I say, on day one of working here, actually before day one, I came in on the Friday before I started on the Monday and got told this is what you're going to be working on. So all weekend I got to be like,
That is a common studio trick to put ideas in people's heads on a Friday afternoon before they're meant to start it on the following Monday because you have a free weekend of thought.
But I mean, also there's like a pub on site. So it's like, come and see the site, you know, we'll buy your coffee at the pub and we'll have a bit of a chat about what you'll be doing. And it's like, yeah, this is great. And then, now that I think about it, they did get 2 free days work out of me thinking, but it's fine. It's a glad
system.
To do it.
Yeah, it's a good system. And I'm glad that you said you feel like you're lucky to have started that way.
Yeah,
I think it must have been a useful grounding in the sorts of games that the 40k studio is making now, because if you had just been introduced to this is how we make codexes, might have set the expectation that that's all you'd be working on for the future. But we've already touched on some of the other games that you've been responsible for working on, and I'm sure there'll be more of that to come in the future. It feels like that's the direction that the studios are taking.
I think there is a a variety of different types of games that are coming out of Games Workshop in general. And yeah, that did set a really good sort of groundwork for the types of things that I'd be working on. Your favorite product,
Realm of Chaos, Wrath and Rapture. Big fan of that one.
And that was really fun to work on. It was a bit of a head twist to sort of to work on. For those of you who are not familiar with the product, it's taking demons, Khorne and Slaanesh demons, and pitting them against each other. And writing about who they are and what they are really, and then providing rules that you can use with both Age of Sigmar and with Warhammer 40,000. Two sets of rules, one for each game system. And that was really cool and really exciting, and the way that you talked about it going into that project was really, it got my mind racing. Like, oh, this is going to be great. We can focus just on the demons and their animosity within the Realm of Chaos and how it's, the great game of them fighting and for ascendancy and this sort of thing. Sitting down to actually write it, though, was immensely difficult, because as soon as you say, all right, we're going to be talking about these demons, but we're going to have rules for 40K and rules for Age of Sigmar. So you can't write about anyone that's specific to 40K or specific to Age of Sigmar in that, because the background has to apply to both rule systems. You lose like a lot of tricks, you can talk about bloodletters doing cool stuff, slashing their way through like armies of like mailed champions and stuff like that. But when you have to do that in a way that isn't referencing anything that's fantasy or anything that's sci-fi, you need to work a lot harder. But again, I think that was right for the product, because what you end up doing is you start talking about the demons as they fight against the other demons. And that's what that product's all about, is demons fighting other demons. Mm-hmm. Which is what's cool about it.
In the very realm of chaos,
In the realm of chaos. The crazy, not goose chase, but the chase across realms and through realities and through time and that sort of thing.
And that was a good bit of fun, wasn't it? Because that was wholly invented for the purposes of that story, the tale of Karanak hunting the infernal and rapturous through time and space.
And it fit really well with what we wanted to do with that battle box. It was just really different from the quote unquote normal things that we do. Starting that job, working on a slightly odd project in Shadow War Armageddon, definitely gave me a good foundation for, you're going to be doing some different things. And that's always cool, because it all adds to the overall experience of what you're getting as a hobbyist. Even if you don't engage with every single game or every single box, this fact that there's stuff out there that caters to your specific interests, I think, is always really great. And that's one thing you find when you're writing, is that the people, who work here, they're like everyone else in the world. You have armies and factions that you like more than others because they're the ones that you personally appeal to you. And I think that's really good, rather than everything being kind of homogenous. There's ones that really you personally latch onto because they speak to a certain part of your personality or your psyche, whereas others don't do that as much initially. And sometimes you'll find yourself working on a project for an army that perhaps isn't one of the ones that you're naturally drawn to. And that's also a challenge, but also really rewarding, because what you end up doing is digging deep into, right, why is this faction cool? Why do these people who love this army so much, what is it they love so much about it? And when you start drilling down into that, you find yourself becoming like sucked in by it and learning to love it as well. And by the end of it, thinking like, yeah, no, they were right all along. These guys are cool.
It's quite a useful human exercise in trying to consider why other people might have a different perspective from you and not just absolutely insisting they're wrong.
Absolutely, yeah. And you've got to just take your biases out of it and look at, all right, why is this a good thing? If I was a fan of this, why would I be a fan of this? And what's awesome about it? You can't just talk about it in sort of like flippant terms. Like the Drukhari, for example, was one where like I hadn't, I knew who they were and I'd read some of their books before, but it was not something that I was naturally drawn to in a strong way, in the way that some people are. And so coming to work on that book and thinking like, what is the thing that draws people in about this? And the fact that there was this intrigue and there was this high society that was very elegant and yet so horrifically brutal, and it was these extremes of every type, extremes of wealth and poverty, of power and powerlessness, extremes of actual space and dimensions within Kamara, the extremes to which they would go to harm their enemies and harm their supposed allies and you know, turn the tables on people that they'd been fighting alongside. All these things, these extremes, just meant that there was something in there for everyone. Mm. And finding that in this kind of labyrinthine kind of, you know, court of psychopaths and sadists, that was really exciting. And I came away from that absolutely loving the Drukhari. Which also makes me feel like I'm more of a sadist and a bad person for doing that. But that's the, yeah, that's the effect that it has on you. The more you work on these things, the more you fall
it's
in love with them.
It's just that you don't have a soul.
That's fine. Recognize
who you truly are.
But I've realized that now, yeah. And that process helped me come to that conclusion.
And I imagine if you'd looked at the Drukhari and looked at them and thought, well, they've got pointy ears, presumably that's why people are mad for them, and you'd written that into every line or aspect of background, someone would have handed it back to you at some stage.
Yeah, my first draft did not pass, you know, when I said pointy ears next, you know.
And that's lunch. Yeah. So how do you go about identifying what is understood to be the coolest stuff to most of the hobbyists who would be into something like the Drukhari, for instance?
I think what it is for most people, talking to other writers, this is certainly what they've said as well, is that the stuff that you're not naturally as into, you tend not to read as deeply about it.
Sure.
You tend not to explore every avenue of that faction's culture and history and ways of battle and that sort of thing. And as soon as you start doing that, you read what's been written in the past, or if it's working on something that's a bit new, perhaps there's new models involved, mm-hmm. and you're developing new intellectual property for them. When you really start drilling down into it and getting into the nitty-gritty, that's when that stuff rises to the surface, the stuff that really makes these factions appealing. Like at the surface level, I think for a lot of people, is you see the photos of the miniatures or the miniatures themselves or the artwork of the miniatures, and there'll be an instant thing of, this is something for me. Yeah. Like I love what this looks like. Or it might be, you might have a slightly less sort of fiery reaction to it if it's something that doesn't click with you straight away. And then you might learn what their shtick is, you know, like for Drukhari, it's that they are these piratical raiders who torture people to prolong their own sort of debased ways of life. And if that's something that appeals to you, you're a bad person. But, you know, it's also either that appeals to you straight away or it may not appeal to you straight away. But as you dig deeper and deeper, like for a lot of people, that will be the sort of end point. They'll think like, oh, you know what, that faction is not for me. There's plenty of others that are really cool that appeal to me more strongly.
So devoid of external stimulus or professional briefing, which factions or bits of the 41st millennium do appeal to you the most?
The most? Possibly demons.
Mm-hmm.
That's an odd one.
Mm.
I think what I like about Chaos Demons is the fact that it's such an existential threat, like beyond understanding. Like one of the best things for me personally in Warhammer 40,000 is that each of the Xenos races and even Chaos is presented in a way that it's humanity's best understanding of this thing. But it's really beyond proper human understanding. Like any given human can't really understand the Imperium, let alone a whole nother sort of body out there that operates completely differently. Like to try and understand Eldari if you're a hive ganger is just, you know, absolutely bonkers. And Demons is kind of the epitome of that, and yet also sort of it's the most understandable because it's just the expressions of what people are at their absolute worst or their absolute extreme. And having that inherent contradiction, I think makes them really fun both to write about and to read about, and the things that they can do and what they represent for other factions, being a sort of paradox of the thing there that's the most horrible thing to encounter and yet born out of those other races born out of humanity, born out of the Eldari. That is really terrifying. And yeah, it's that terror, I think, that draws me to it. And yeah, that sounds really horrible, but I guess that is it. It's things that induce sort of terror. Astra Militarum's another one. Like, I love reading about Astra Militarum. I love writing about Astra Militarum. I love seeing Astra Militarum armies. And I think, again, because you can, or at least I can, somewhat relate to that in a way, and yet at the same time can't relate to it at all, because I've never been in an army that's made up of billions of people, you know, like that's not something I've done.
What is the biggest army you've ever been in?
Oh, probably an army of one, you know, when I've gotten a bit scrappy. No. Yeah, it's that ability to relate and yet be completely disconnected. And I think that's what the Warhammer 40,000 setting does, is it creates an environment where everything is ramped up, not to 10, but up to 40,000. You know, everything is so extreme to the point that you can't relate to it, and yet there's these little bits where you see yourself or you see an aspect of humanity that you recognize, for good or for bad. You see people being heroic, you see people being tyrannical, you see people being selfless, you see these things and that allows you to sort of put yourself into it, or put a story that you've thought of into it, or understand a story from your life through that lens. And yeah, so I think it's almost those two extremes for me. Astra Militarum is the most human thing, demons is the least human thing, and yet, you know, being a human in the 41st millennium is like completely unrelatable, and being a warp entity that's based on emotions is kind of is relatable, because that's something that's part of all of us. So yeah, it's those extremes, those contradictions. Okay. That's what I like. Yeah,
that's very good.
Yeah,
I guess demons are tricky because there's been so much written about them by Games Workshop for 30 plus years, ever since Realm of Chaos, Slaves to Darkness, and it's been explained to us as probably rational humans of third millennium terror how demons come to be in the 41st millennium, and then all of that understanding is stripped away from almost everybody in the 41st millennium, and they're ostensibly, the Grey Knights are still wiping out people who know, even though there are demons pouring out of warp rifts all over the galaxy. So they're busy, and that is also quite a grim sign of what demons represent to the Imperium, that ultimately chaos is still the eternal threat, that if the Emperor stops his fight, or the gods of chaos win, the entire galaxy is taken over and unreason floods in.
It's the idea that, like, the chaos space marines, you know, they are bad news, and they're, you know, spread out across the galaxy. They could attack any part of the Imperium at any time, as far as the Imperium knows. You know, that's a constant threat. But the end game of that threat is real space basically being exploded and folded out into, like, the realm of chaos, and that becoming reality. And that's so much worse. And the demons that manifest in real space just being the tip of the iceberg, I think, speaks to that threat and that dread, and it being so horrible that even knowing that it exists, for someone to know that it exists is a threat to all of humanity. And so you gotta wipe those people out. Like, that's a horrible level of threat, that if you found out that it exists, you've got to be killed for the good of everyone else.
And it suggests that maybe the Imperium aren't the good guys. And, like, it's not good against evil. It is, well, the forces of chaos want this because that's what they do. It's just like a primal thing. You can't argue with it. It's not subjectively good or bad. That's just what they're there to do. And the forces of the Imperium are trying to stop that.
Well, I think that's...
That's all there is.
Yeah, well, that's what's great about it, is that when you get to that scale, it's beyond good or evil.
Yeah.
It's just effect. It's like, from your perspective, what can you choose to do? If you have any agency at all, what can you choose to do, and how will that affect other people? And pretty much whatever you do, a bunch of people are going to die, and it's your choice as to which people are going to die. You know, as a noble defender of the Imperium, you can make calls to, okay, we're going to defend this world by diverting all our resources, all our troops here. Those other three worlds, they are going to get devoured, but this one produces the guns, so we're going to defend this world. I guess that's... Is that good?
It kicks the can down the road for another solar month, or whatever it might be, that allows the war to keep being fought for another month, and then we'll take stock again.
It's beyond the question of good or evil. It's why you know, the Imperium's not the Imperium of good, and chaos is not called evil. You know, it's just a system by which everything is rigidly ordered to the detriment of trillions of people, but for the survival of them, or absolute anarchy, also to the detriment of trillions of people, but to the good of some of them. Mm. And depending on where you stand, your perspective on that dichotomy is vastly different, and it's that tension between them that allows people to genuinely say, like, yeah, the Imperium is noble and good, or, you know, chaos has the right idea, and to feel valid in that, because it is about perspective, and it is colossal powers clashing against each other for survival, fighting to annihilate the other. Mm. And it's, yeah, it's impossible to objectively say one is good, one is evil.
And even the points that we made about the Drakkari earlier on, that, yeah, you know, if you identify with what the Drakkari like, you might be a bit of a wrong'un. But ultimately, if you identify with many of the factions in the 41st millennium,
yeah,
it's not a manifesto. None of this is being presented as, this is where we'd like our future to lead us. It's a cautionary tale.
Yeah, if you think orcs are great because it's fun to have a fight, and, you know, that's not necessarily the most healthy thing in our society. And yet at the same time, it's somewhat admirable that the only ones who are kind of having a good time in the 41st millennium are the Greenskins. Mm. You know, at least they enjoy what they do. Again, the Drakkari might at times as well, but, you know, they've got that constant bill to pay. Yeah, but that's what I think is exciting about it, is that you have all these really disparate things, all of which come with massive negatives, but you can kind of see the perspective of why, how they've come to that conclusion. Yeah. And you can see hints of how maybe they could resolve it if it weren't for X, Y, and Z. Mm. Like, why can't the Eldarian humanity, like, work together to fight their common enemies? Well, because a lot of the time they're enemies with each other, and you can't trust the Xenos. And so inevitably they end up fighting each other. Yeah. And you can understand why the individuals make those decisions of attack the Eldari, attack the humans. But taking a step back from the perspective of us, from the perspectives of the readers, you can see that hubris and that tragedy.
Yeah.
And the inevitability that there will only be war, and you understand it. And yeah, it's interesting because it says things about real life and about society. And I think it genuinely does help you sort of learn and grow and give you a new perspective on other things in your life. Mm-hmm. And again, not that you should try and live your life in the way that some of these people live. Ideally, that's not what we're going for. But, you know, I think it does give a very interesting reflection of humanity. Mm. And some of the best parts of humanity and some of the darkest parts of humanity as well.
So we talked a bit about some of the codexes that you've worked on.
Yes.
We should touch on Blackstone Fortress, because,
oh yes, please,
that must have taken up quite a big part of your time over the last year or so.
Yeah, a bit more than a year. Thinking back, it's something that we started off very much with proper, like, R&D, sitting down to do research and development. People other than myself had thought about this project and what sort of shape it might take as a board game, and the setting of wanting to explore a Blackstone Fortress, and a Blackstone Fortress that we hadn't necessarily seen before, and the miniatures work. A lot of that had already been done, and there was a really strong idea for some of the things we wanted to achieve, but then a lot of the other details were free for the project team to come up with. Getting to work on that was massively exciting, and there's all sorts of things working on it we realized were uncharted territory in the 41st millennium. And that was the most fun thing working on Blackstone Fortresses, is getting to see the 41st millennium from a perspective we hadn't necessarily seen it from before. Yeah. So we've been inside Blackstone Fortresses in a couple of different ways, in Battlefleet Gothic and in Rise of the Primarch. Mm-hmm. You know, we've seen Blackstone Fortresses, but having one that's been discovered and hasn't really been locked down by any faction, and the people who are all showing up there are all ragtag and stuff, and they don't really understand what it is they found exactly, and it's beyond their understanding, that was really exciting. That was being able to show something, again, from a more a perspective that perhaps is a bit more relatable to someone like myself. Like, if I was to, walk outside here today and find an ancient space station floating out there that had been slumbering for untold thousands of years, I'd also probably be a bit confused and curious and not exactly know the full extent of it straight away. And being able to follow characters who had a vested interest in this structure but didn't necessarily have all the answers was great, because it let us take the players along this journey of slowly starting to find out more and more about what is this thing, why is it here, what's it doing. And yeah, really got to give that boots on the ground kind of perspective, that battlefield eye view inside this bizarre place that didn't act like it should necessarily. Yeah. And hadn't been taken over by the Imperium, it hadn't been taken over by Chaos, but seemed to have its own agency as well. Yeah, that was a lot of fun. But the other areas that we realized hadn't really been covered off yet is we had to give these people these ships to fly to visit the Blackstone Fortress. We hadn't done a lot of work on vessels of that size, and so we put in a lot of work researching, okay, what class of vessels would these be, you know, this sort of size that's bigger than what you'd see on a 40k like tabletop, but much smaller than you'd have in something like Battlefleet Gothic or something like that. Yeah, getting to research that, not just for the Imperium but for Kroot and stuff like that, was really fun.
That works. It's very exciting to see the outputs, I think, for everyone connected with the hobby. And I know it comes up sometimes in codexes, and we might talk about how does a regiment of guardsmen get onto the planet's surface, because where there is not a dedicated plastic citadel miniature for a dropship or something, you might ask the question. And I know I've talked with Andy Clark a lot about Imperial Knights and how Imperial Knights are deployed on the surface of a planet.
He loves talking about how they get onto...
Yeah. It's good stuff, because I mean, we want to know as hobbyists and enthusiasts, and it doesn't always, you can't always make space for it in the codex that is trying to tell you how to collect an army and paint it correctly, but you can't get away with that for a game like Blackstone Fortress where we need artwork for those. You have to show them.
Yeah. And I think what's cool about that is it's not going to be the same way every time. Like, not every Imperial person has a shuttle of the same size to get them around the place, depending on who they are and what they need it for. That's going to look different. Same as not every knight house is going to deploy their knights in the same way. Not every Astra Militarum regiment is going to do landings in the same way. What we can show is like a little bit that helps to inspire that kind of thing for, again, people's imagination to take over, because it's a vast, vast universe. Mm-hmm. I think in the real world, you know, people can travel around countries by boat or by plane or by helicopter or by...
Next you'll say there are different types of planes. Madness.
That's crazy talk. so taking that onto a galactic scale, you can imagine there are so many varieties of this sort of thing. And being able to hint at just a few and show like a little glimpse of one or two of these.
And you've said show a few times now, and it is that show don't tell approach, isn't it?
You
don't say all rogue traders use this type of shuttle, you say that rogue trader uses that type of shuttle.
Yeah.
And if people want to imagine, well, another rogue trader could use that if I wanted them to, or equally they could have a completely different flamboyant Eldari design ship if they wanted to.
Absolutely. And it's exactly that, showing variety and showing exemplars of things like in Blackstone Fortress. Two of the characters from the Ministorum have a very Ministorum-y looking vessel that looks like a big flying cathedral, and you think like, yeah, that seems like pretty legit of what they'd have, and they're very much exemplars. But then you show people who have kind of anti-exemplary things that you wouldn't necessarily expect them to have. Like, why are these two rattlings like on an old like Admech junk hauler like flying around? Like, what's going on there? And it's that ability to show not everyone fits into the box that they would necessarily be deemed to fit into. They've had their own life and progressed in their own way in this universe and had their own stories that backdate from the story that we're telling you now. And that's what's led here. And so your story going forward can be as varied as you want it to be as well. It's about having that mix, which is really exciting. But yeah, overall, that was an immensely satisfying project or suite of projects to be working on, just because of that ability to pry the lid off something that we hadn't really looked so deep into before. So I don't know if you ever did that thing. I did it a lot as a kid where you lift up like a stone and you see all these little bugs and you're like, where did they come from? I didn't see them before. It was like doing that, but inside was Urghuls and spindle drones and that sort of thing that blast your face off. It was great fun. Yeah.
And I think people are delighted to see the types of characters that were featured in that box, the mm-hmm. adventurers and the hostiles, because when the default way of receiving information about the 41st millennium is rule books and codexes for the 40K tabletop war game, you get an emphasis on the things that feature in pitched mass battles in army level formations. But we know intellectually that there are other weirder, darker corners of the 41st millennium, and it's great to see that represented in miniature form, but then also backed up with that background, because it keeps it alive and it lets people know. I think as Warhammer grows bigger and there are different ways of interacting with the hobby, if there are people who just want to collect and paint the weird, grungier bits of the corners of the IP, you absolutely can.
Yeah.
There are ways of getting them on the tabletop and putting them in a game. A knight might step on them, but that's fine. You can play the tabletop war game. You know the risks, but it's a great example to show, I think, of the other sorts of games that are available and ways of interacting with that intellectual property in ways that you might enjoy, because big massed battles are maybe not for everybody, but that granularity and the choice, again, the opportunity to be inspired by different aspects of the hobby or the IP.
Yeah, and I think you said something really important there, is like keeping parts of the IP alive. I think I'm certainly guilty of this, and I work here. Sometimes if you haven't seen a miniature of something, it slips further and further and back in your mind if you haven't seen a miniature in a while. And there's so much stuff that's out there, you know, Ambles, for example, you know, they've been talked about and they've been around for a long time. And so it's when you see like a miniature of them that you're like, oh yeah, no, that is, yeah, it's a real thing, and it reminds you.
Yeah.
And working on these projects that remind you of those things, that there's other things out there that you don't necessarily see. Mm. Man of Iron, for example, you know, it's like, okay, is that, I guess there probably are still some of those around, maybe.
That's a show don't tell thing again.
Yeah, yeah.
That one is, what does that mean?
Yeah, because you'd never end up writing that in a codex. You'd say, oh, by the way, there's at least this one guy walking around.
As you know, Bob, yeah. There's one man of iron walking around.
But yeah, being able to focus in on that. It's almost like looking at the 41st millennium with a microscope, where you get to zoom in on this little bubble, where instead of being like whole armies fighting for the survival of hive cities or moons or planets or that sort of thing, you're focusing on a handful of like ragtag people in this really weird environment that have been thrown together, who don't really trust each other or have the same goals, but they all want to survive, and that currently is more important than their animosity. So they'll work together for now and hope for the best, because that's better than the alternative.
And still set against the backdrop of the Chaos Gods are trying to eat reality and the Emperor's trying to hold them out.
Yeah, they've still got all of that sort of stuff to worry about, you know. A lot of stresses, I would say, you know.
Not a great life.
Yeah, and yet still somehow people manage to curate like lovely mustaches and stuff like that, you know. It's really, it's laudable, you know.
I'm just checking him out on the box behind you at the moment. Yeah. He looks very dapper, very debonair. Yeah. So do you think working on projects like Shadow War, Blackstone, has that helped set you up for your current role now as 40K product developer?
Yeah, I think definitely. So as you well know, having previously worked this exact role that I stepped into when you came over here, product developer, the job title, what it entails is basically designing these projects that other people sort of contribute to, planning out books and campaigns and codexes and this sort of thing, that then the other immensely talented members of staff, the writers, the rules writers, artists, photographers, graphic designers, editors, all work on together, and you're, as a product developer, sitting at the center making sure they're all pulling in the same direction towards that goal of what the product eventually should be, and the best possible version of that product. Having worked on a variety of different types of projects before has helped immensely in that. It's not like I just wrote codexes and then came into this role and write another codex. It's seeing the scope of what we can do with Warhammer 40,000. It's not just one thing. It's not a linear path of this is 40K. It's a vast galaxy, both in terms of how we describe it and in terms of what's written about it and what it is in people's heads. and that can never be captured in one book. So all you can do is take snapshots of it. And really what it is when you're planning out one of these books, I've found, is you're just deciding the angle from which you take that photo. You're deciding what bit of the Warhammer 40,000 universe do we want to capture with the space that we have in this book. And that's really all you can do, and it's finding the most exciting way to do that that serves the purpose that you want to do and gives the best experience for the people you're trying to cater to. If it's a codex, it's you got to think like, right, the people who play this army, what is it that they're looking for? What's the coolest thing for them? And how does that fit alongside the other codexes that already exist? If it's a campaign book or something like that, what story do we want to tell? How do we want to move things forward? What areas of the ongoing storyline do we want to give more detail to? What characters do we want to draw out? And at the same time, looking at the miniatures department at Games Workshop and the awesome stuff that they've produced, how do we best bring that to light and showcase that in a way that makes it exciting and understandable to people who are seeing these miniatures for the first time, and yet at the same time making sure there's enough mystery there that again, we're not telling the whole story. We're giving just enough to sort of whet your appetite and let your imagination take over and let you breathe life into those miniatures when you paint them and you put them on the tabletop and that sort of thing. I'm sure you can talk about this as well. It's a very challenging role, but massively satisfying to see these things come together and see the people around you who are so good at what they do all working together. It's sort of like a swirl around you that slowly coalesces into something that actually looks like a real book. It's like, oh, wow, this is amazing.
I used to get hugely stressed out at the thoughts of the things that wouldn't make it into the book, just in terms of intellectual property, painting information, history, rules, miniatures, the number of things that didn't make it into the book, some of them still haunt me. Mm. And I think what you were saying about the angle that you're taking on the book itself each time, you can never fit the entire collected histories of the Ultramarines chapter, let alone Legion, into any Space Marine book. And I think that understanding that you can only show selected highlights, the selected highlights that have made people think Ultramarines, whatever the example might be, have been cool for 25 plus years. You just have to distill that stuff and represent it, hopefully in a way that touches on the nostalgic heartstrings of people who've been collecting Ultramarines for all that period of time, but also makes Ultramarines appear cool to the new people.
You know, you can take the third company of the Ultramarines and write volumes about their history, all of which is super exciting, or you can sum up who they are in a sentence to make them super exciting, or something between those two things. And every time you come to write about any of the factions or any aspect of Warhammer 40,000, you've got to make that call, like, where is this going to sit? And making that call, you got to think about, well, what's the function of this? Is it because I'm telling a story that someone's going to buy a book for and sit down and read over the course of a couple weeks or a couple months or however long? Or is it something that lets them dive into this world and lets them, like you say, paint their miniatures and collect their army and play their games in a way that is meaningful and has weight? And it's not always the same answer from book to book, and within a given book it's not always the same answer. Like, different pages, different sections do different jobs. Photography and art sits next to words, and there's background writing, there's rules, the way the pages are laid out, the colors used, the page furniture, and this sort of thing. It all sort of adds up to something that is more than the some of the individual parts. And I think you'd probably agree with this. It's impossible at the beginning of a project as the product developer, when you plan out, right, here's what I think the project should be, it's impossible to sort of fully envisage what that will be, because you rely on the talents of the people around you to bring more to the table than you've asked of them.
Yeah.
And they do consistently.
Otherwise you'd be micromanaging very talented creative people.
Yeah.
Not getting the best work out of them, because you'd be telling them to execute your poor idea rather than their good idea.
Exactly. I know I am not the best rules writer and artist and photographer and layout person. And begrudgingly, I'll admit, I'm not the best background writer either, because there are other amazing people who are even more experienced.
That's all it is. Just out of practice.
I was. But you can't... Like you said, you can't micromanage and be the best at. What you have to do is provide a clear sort of guiding light as to, here's the thing that we should all be pulling towards. Here's the goal that we want to achieve. Now, the rest of the team, you can each work on your individual disciplines and do the coolest possible version of the thing that you do, so long as it all sort of feeds into this one one sort of end point. And the reason you have to do that is so that you don't have background talking about one thing, the art showing something else, and photography going in one direction, the rules doing something else. Like everything has to be cohesive. And when that comes together, it's seamless and you don't notice it. And that's the thing. I remember reading these books growing up, is you don't notice the parts that go into it. You just read a book and it's amazing. Like it feels amazing. It looks amazing. You get sucked into that world. You're reading words and looking at pictures. You're seeing the miniatures photographed on the tabletop and looking at the rules of what they do and thinking, oh, that's really cool. I see how that works. It's all part of like a singular experience. And that's like that's how all of the products should end up, is that sort of thing where you don't see the stitches. You just enjoy this final, this fully realized thing as a whole. And there's often a lot of bumps along the way, but the trick is making sure that those bumps aren't seen at the end, I guess.
As I say, case by case basis approach to things, because the backstory, the background of 40K, the publishing history, there is 30 or so years of expectations or assumptions or understandings that hobbyists have got in their heads. And I remember looking with envious eyes sometimes at the Warhammer Age of Sigmar studio. It's really easy for you to know what you're writing a book about. It's literally just the models that exist. And we've had discussions about how you do that in 40K, but the Space Wolves Wolf Priest was always a great example, because from the point at which the studio decided, right, we want to do data sheets and codexes, and if it doesn't have a data sheet, or it doesn't have a model, it doesn't get a data sheet. Mm. And then you start getting things like, but what? We've told people for 30 years that the Space Wolves have Wolf Priests, so it's not, I'm not going to roll back on that. They absolutely do have Wolf Priests. We just haven't made a dedicated miniature for a Wolf Priest that doesn't have a name like Ulrich the Slayer. Mm. So how do you support the people who've converted or built or painted their own Wolf Priests for 30 odd years? And at the moment, it's still that kind of halfway house of, well, you probably take a chaplain and give him a beard and you'll work it out. But there is still that need. Those are some of the stitches, I guess. Yeah. You can definitely see some of the stitching there. Whereas some of the rangers like Adeptus Mechanicus, because we only ever wrote Adeptus Mechanicus and Scutari Cult Mechanicus codexes for the range of models that existed, there weren't any weird grey areas where you had to squint and imagine what that model could be. I hadn't got a question. I was just observing that they're lucky in that Age of Sigmar team. We should blow up some more worlds and just copy what they do.
But even there, I think, like you're right. You can come up with these really sound reasons for doing things in a certain way. And there's always exceptions. It's that whole thing of I before E, except after C, and except for in all those cases where it's not that way. Yeah. And you always find exceptions to the rules that you make for yourself. Mm. But you just, again, what you got to think towards is really the ultimate goal behind every other goal of what you want a book to be or product to be, is if I'm the person who's bought this and read this, is this the coolest version of the thing that it could be? Is this the most engaging, the most engrossing thing, that the thing that makes me think I am so happy that I bought this? Because that's the experiences that I remember, and being really valuable parts of my life, being able to read through a Games Workshop book and just be blown away by it, and not reading it going, oh, okay, I can see they had like an editorial issue here where they had to decide, you know, are we going to spell this word this way or this way, and they went for both ways, one on each page. You don't want people to see that, you know. You just want to have that overwhelming kind of sense of I am in this world now. It's my portal into the Imperium, into the Eye of Terror, wherever it may be, you know. That's all you need it to be. Mm-hmm. And so long as everything goes towards that ultimate goal, you know, you're kind of golden.
Yeah. You want people to have questions, but I have questions that I'm driven to ask because,
And you get those questions by playing games with your friends and talking about it and going online and chatting on community sites and reading Black Library books and buying other codexes and engaging with the hobby however you choose to do it, you know.
It's a positive message. I like that. So what else about product developing? Is there anything that we'd want to acknowledge? Have we done it differently?
I do it well. Okay. I'm not sure how you do it.
Very well.
Oh, okay. Well, you know, there's room for me to improve.
I do think that we would be approaching it differently because my background, I was either Warhammer System Editor was my job title before product developer for 40K. And the editorial aspect was something that I was quite into because I can remember how we've spelled stuff. And I think I've remembered where we've said stuff in the past. And that I had to try to put some distance between me saying, this is how it is in a fictitious future 38,000 years hence. But I could definitely say, this is what Games Workshop published 5 times in a row. I suggest we stick to that one because people might have bought armies or painted armies inspired by that background. And I was always conscious or keen to make sure if anyone wanted to change established IP, which we're definitely at liberty to do, we did it with the best understanding of why it had been that way in the past.
Absolutely. And realizing that, you know, obviously this is, you know, for want of a better term, it is made up by us and
No. We have visions of the future that can't keep
that's,
the, keep
that's
it going.
That's what I mean.
We have visions of the future. We just still.
It's made up by us by what we see.
Yeah. We're oracles, important oracles.
Yeah. But, you know, it is very real to a lot of people and myself included. You know, like it is fiction, but it's fiction that has a lot of meaning.
And it has to be internally consistent.
Yeah.
At a fractal level, like every bit of it, you have to be able to zoom in on and be satisfied that it works.
Yeah, so for me, it's a lot more like approaching history
than
it is approaching fiction. I studied history at university.
Me too.
I remember you saying, and
this
I think
the only real use for it beyond teaching history to people, I think.
It really is, because you do a lot of research and you look into things and you think about the reasons why people would have acted the way they did, and you postulate how would they act going forward. And that's what it is. And you present your case. And we get to present our case in cool books that have amazing artwork and photos and rules that let you go pew, pew, pew at your friends across the tabletop. It does feel like history. And I think being able to convey that feeling to other people so that it can be real for them as well. It's really something that I think it feels like something you can share rather than just making up and telling someone, right, this is what happened. It feels like a truth that you want to share with people. Like, this is the truth of the 41st millennium. It's a grim, dark place, but it's exciting. Yeah.
You can join in.
Yeah.
Everyone can join in. I had a talk, I think it was with Jim Swallow on one of the Warhammer Live chats, Black Library author, Jim Swallow. I think it was Jim Swallow. Apologies if I'm misrepresenting someone else. But he was talking about how this setting, the Warhammer 40,000 setting, you can generate fan fiction for it. And it doesn't feel like it's fan fiction. It doesn't feel like it's like something that sits apart from the official presentation.
Yeah, yeah. I might have been Dan Ebner.
Was that
the
Dan Ebner VoxCast? That was very recent in the real world.
Yeah.
We recorded it ages ago. Anyway, one of those wonderful Black Library authors.
No, that's absolutely, because you're going from the same source material, you know? I was born in 1982. Rogue Trader was what, 1987?
Yep.
Yeah, so there's people writing this before I could really write a lot of words. So what I came into, what I wrote background for and what I'm now doing product developing for is something that has been produced by other people and was real, created by them. And I'm carrying it forth. And there'll be other people who carry it forth after me as well.
There'll be another 40K product developer one day. We'll have to bring them on and grill them. Put them to the questions.
Then there'll be 3 of us.
Then there will be 3.
But we are the custodians of it for now. And that's a responsibility and it's an exciting opportunity. And part of what is involved in that is inspiring the next generation of people who'll carry it forward.
That is a very inspiring take. Thank you very much for your time, Alex Tuxford.
Thank you for having me.
Cheers. Thanks again to Alex, and thank you for watching or listening to the podcast. VoxCast will return in 2 weeks' time, and there'll be another episode of Stormcast released next week. In the meantime, you can check out the Warhammer TV and Warhammer 40,000 Facebook pages for details of other Warhammer TV shows that we're making, or to leave any feedback that you might have about the podcasts. See you soon.